Yeah, it's Marty Friedman.
Electric Lady, here we are.
Hey, this is Marty Friedman here. How you guys all doing? I'm here in New York, Electric Lady Studios, hanging out with my buddy here, Mitch. Mitch Diamond.
Hello.
And he's going to be assisting me and kind of prodding me and probing me and asking all kinds of strange questions about my guitar playing. And we're going to get into a lot of details, a lot of cool stuff, and a lot of stuff that you would have thought he would have never done that, because we're going to go back into stuff from my way, way back past, which is kind of cool, and I'll explain why after we get a tuning chord. Here's a chord. That's E, just handle it. Anytime we jam, that's a tuning reference. These examples that I'm going to use from past recordings and stuff may not exactly be in that E tuning, so you'll just have to take care of it yourself. Okay, one thing about this video that I think is going to be cool is we're going to go back into a lot of the old stuff that I did. And the reason for doing that is I found that when I was a beginning guitarist and a young guitarist, that when I tried to learn some of the coolest stuff of my favorite guitarists, it would usually be way too hard for me, and I couldn't learn the details and the nuances of the way they played. So what I wound up doing was going back to the earliest recording I could find of that guitarist and try to learn that first, you know, because that's usually when he's least evolved. For example, when I was growing up, one of my favorite guitarists was Uli Roth. And of course, I heard the great solos of like Sales of Sharon and, you know, Catch Your Train and everything from In Trance and all those great albums and stuff. And I couldn't really play them. And I'm like, God, how am I going to learn this? You know, it's really hard to learn when everything's flying by so fast. So I found the first album that he released with the Scorpions, which was Fly to the Rainbow, and I found that his playing was still kind of in a young, building up stage, and it wasn't really that difficult, and I found that I could figure it out, and that really led me to learning his nuances and his important playing habits, and it made it easier for me to learn the more difficult stuff, the stuff that I thought was really cool. You know, of course, the stuff in the old days may not have been as cool because he wasn't quite as good, but I learned the most important details about the way he played. Anyway, enough about that guy, because he's just too good to even talk about. But what we're going to do is we're going to go back into like some demos that I did when I was like 2 years old, a long time ago, the first time I ever set foot into a studio. And I'm going to play along the guitar parts, and you can see how my playing has changed and what you can learn from the very embryo of my guitar playing. And I'm probably going to learn a lot of this too, because I haven't played like this in 15, 16 years. So let's see what happens. That ending part is the part where you're supposed to like hold the note out and like go like this and be really cool. So what do you think about my checkered past way back in the distance of time before anybody had even heard of anything that was really heavy? That was what was going on in the kid's life.
That was heavy. It was good. Very good. I liked the playing.
Thank you.
I liked some of the pull-offs you were doing towards the beginning of that first solo.
Mm-hmm. At the time, I was really influenced by Kiss, you know, like you are as well. And I find that it was easy to get gratification learning songs that I could play, like, in a couple months, you know, as opposed mm-hmm. to learning these big, huge projects, you know, like learning Beethoven's Fifth or something.
Right.
You know, I found gratification by learning the Kiss songs and the Ramones songs, you know, and so my lead playing had evolved to, like, an Ace Frehley influenced kind of state, but I was still trying to emote the same things that I'm trying to emote now, I think. You know, the pull-offs, I think you're talking about something where I was going that kind of thing.
Right, very Ace Frehley-ish type
very
of stuff.
Very repetitive and kind of builds up the tension. And what one thing that I've been doing since the beginning of when I play guitar is do something that repeats and let the chord work in the background do all the work. The chords are changing behind that. I'm just repeating this one pattern, and while I'm repeating this pattern, the chords are making a melody happen and making a feeling happen. So the lead is actually kind of being a rhythm, if you know what I mean. And it usually, at that point, you know, being as rough as it was, would lead up to like a really kind of singing note, you know, kind of crying, you know, and even to this day, I mean, a big part of my playing is making the notes cry. Mm-hmm. And it dates back even that far back, and you know, I always try to get a real sad singing, just make you want to just throw up how sad it is, you know, and just crying notes, you know, and I think it's not very hard to do. I'd only been playing maybe 2 years at the time of this tape, and it's something I still strive to do today. And sometimes I listen back to that tape and I'm like, God, why can't I play like that anymore, you know? I got directly to the point, you know, without a lot of crap in between, you know? And now I've got so much knowledge, not that I know a lot, but I've learned so much in the last 17 years, hopefully. Sometimes that gets in the way of the basic raw point that I want to get across. So it's a very hard thing to do to find that innocence mm-hmm. again, you know? So that's what's good about learning this old stuff.
Were there any episodes from that first band that you could remember?
Just that we were like really a band, you know. At that time, it was called Deuce, and inspired by the Kiss song. And we were like a local band that was popular in a small town around Washington. And we had all the things that people growing up have, like as rock stars. You know, we had all the adulation of the local neighborhood mm-hmm. fans and stuff, and all the drug lifestyle, you know, that happens to usually bands like Deep Purple and these famous bands. You got everybody giving you drugs and stuff, and we were just like, wow, this is great. We love this life, you know. It's just your basic rock and roll life, and I'm actually glad I got it out of my system when I was 17 or 16, you know, or 17 or something like that, and I really straightened up my act after that band, you know. But that band, I have a lot of great fun memories with that. And mm-hmm. so I listened back to it. The music has a lot of validity to me because I still meant the music the same way as I do now. It wasn't like I was trying to make music. That was the music I was making, you know, as opposed to like a first demo where you're just trying to learn how to play.
We'll be right back.
I bet back then you never thought you'd be in one of the biggest heavy metal bands of all time.
It's funny because at that time I really played like I was, you know, and we felt like we were because we had a lot of the adulation, you know, that major bands get, you know, and we were little kids, you know, so it really felt like big rock staritis, you know, to us. So we didn't know the difference, you know, we felt like we were playing at Budokan, you know, or something, or Tokyo Dome, or any right. famous venue, you know, and so at that time it was really, really exciting because I just began playing and our band was really popular, so I had this great feeling, and I'm like, wow, this is great. I think this is what I want to do with my life, and little did I know I was going to have to, like, struggle my ass off for the next 10 years to, like, do anything where I could, like, make a living, but I think I've always been trying to recreate the feeling that I had, you know. We felt like we were the hottest band in town, probably because we were. I mean, we were, like, the heaviest band in town, that's for sure, and so being in Megadeth, I see a lot of parallels to that, you know, and it's great because when we play in Megadeth, it's like we're the stuff. I mean, there's no question when we go out and play, even on a bad night, it's just going to kick everybody's ass. And we have those very rarely, so we have this really kind of pride about playing. And I think I'm glad I had a lot of good experiences at the beginning, but I also had to work really hard and get very little recognition in the years in between. You know, a lot of hard times, you know, in a band called Hawaii, you know, which was kind of underground popular band, and all things led to where I am now. And in Megadeth, you know, we played the biggest places in the world, and we've got great dedicated fans everywhere, and it just feels great, you know, and it's something that I take a lot of pride in, but I have to strive to continue to keep it going. I mean, it's not like the type of thing that if we just decided to relax and stop working, it would keep going. I mean, it would die like that, you know, and there's a strong work ethic going on.
Right. So how hard is it to deal with the pressure of you're in the spotlight all the time?
It's about finding peace in other times, you know, because sometimes life is so hectic and you just got to get into it, dive into work and just do it and enjoy it, you know, and the time that you have off, you have to hold really sacred and really let your batteries recharge, you know, and I like playing music, so I don't look at it as pressure. You know, I look at it as this is what I want to do, you know. Pressure is meeting a deadline for something. Pressure is some jobs where you don't have the gratification, you know. And sometimes pressure is rising to the occasion, like we just played these festivals over in Germany, and the tone was really, really bad for my guitar, and I didn't know why. And my guitar tech told me after the show that my rig was broken. It was dropped from one of the trucks. But he knew that if he told me that before the show, I would, like, go out of my mind and just freak out. But I was just thinking, God, my tone's a little peculiar. It's just not that great tonight, you know. So I was just trying to play my best. And just little things like that, you know. You just got to adapt and improvise, you know, and go with every situation. And sometimes it's not always great, but, you know, even though the tone was bad and it was a hard time, there were still thousands of people listening and enjoying what I was doing, so I have to be thankful for that. And I just keep that in mind.
Do you feed off the crowd?
Absolutely, absolutely. Sometimes it's very strange. You know, we play places like Europe and people are out of their minds in the audience. They're just screaming all the time, and you just get used to that. And what's funny is we went to Europe and then we toured Japan after that, and in Japan it's totally different. They actually listen to the music you're playing, so it's dead silent during the song. So you can mistake that for the crowd not liking what you're doing, and you think, God, are we sucking that bad? Do they hate us? And it took a couple days in Japan to get used to that, you know, and then I realized that in Japan they're actually listening more than the rest of the world, you know. A lot of places people are just beating the hell out of each other, you know, and having a good time, which is cool. But in Japan, they're like listening to all the details of how you're playing, and they cheer at the end of the solo, which means they listen to the solo, and I get joy from that, you know, because I feel that they care what's going on, you know, and when any audience does that. And it's just a kind of thing where you feed off the audience, even whether or not they're getting into it or not. You just know the fact that they came there, you have to play for them because they paid to see you. So you can't say, well, this is a dead crowd, so I'm going to just play like crap, you know. That attitude happens. You feel like doing that because, God, these guys are just mellow. They're not getting into it. But you got to really remember that you're there to entertain them. And no matter what they do, even if they just lie asleep, they paid their money, and you got to just kick ass and do your best. And sometimes you just got to do what you don't feel like doing.
Could you describe what heavy metal is to you?
Heavy metal to me is everything your parents are supposed to hate. It's something that is kind of rebellion, kind of the type of thing where you go into your bedroom and just crank, and you just piss off your neighbors, and abrasive, offensive, and all that stuff. And when it's not that, you're doing it wrong. You know what I mean? And I see a parallel to the music from the 50s, mm-hmm. you know, and they hated Elvis, you know, because his image, you know, is leather jackets and just kind of an image that was not like the parents of those days, you know. And in the 60s, there wasn't really anything like that, in my opinion. And in the 70s came this heavy metal sound, you know, it started with Black Sabbath, I think, mm-hmm. because it was just the most overdriven guitar that had ever happened. And so people started to enjoy that beautiful sound of a distorted guitar. I mean, there's something like almost medicinal about that. It feels so good to hear it, and like you're feeling down and school sucks and your parents are mad at you and you got all kinds of problems, and you go into your room and you just like turn heavy metal up very loud. It's going to do something good for you, not like say disco music or pop music, you know. Maybe there's good music, all other kinds of music are great, but there's something about heavy metal that just kind of cures problems, especially authority kind of problems.
So that's your philosophy?
Oh yeah, definitely. I mean, when the first Kiss album came out, I mean, if you wanted to piss somebody off, all you had to do was show them the album cover, you know, and the Ramones and stuff. It was definitely for young people and for people who are just aggressive. And
as a guitar player, what's the lead guitarist's role in heavy metal music?
I think the lead player, you know, in the traditional sense, is the guy who comes out in the middle of the song and plays some kind of really high-pitched, wailing, screaming sound, technically, you know what I mean?
Just wail away.
Yeah, and there's really no way to get around that being a fact. I mean, people have tried to change the format of heavy metal and breed it with other kinds of music, but classic heavy metal is there's a front man, lead singer, maybe he plays guitar, maybe he doesn't. There's a bass player and a drummer and a lead player. Couple verses, and then there's a solo. And the solo usually winds up with something very exciting at the end. Mm-hmm. And this is just a fact. Like, music from other countries has a format. Like, Indian music has its ragas and its rhythmic time signatures and stuff, and it always follows a format. And Chinese music and Japanese music and music from all cultures has formats, and even heavy metal, roughly put, has its own format, and that's what it is.
Where is it going? Where is heavy metal music going? What's the future?
It's really weird, you know. I'm hoping that there's going to be like kind of a resurgence of straight ahead heavy metal, you know, because it's kind of changing and there's a lot of different things happening in heavy metal. But it's like music goes in cycles, you know. There was the 50s, which I consider to be heavy metal for those days. And then there was the 60s, where all these hippies talking about peace and love and stuff like that. And then came the 70s, where people are saying, screw all that stuff, let's play something aggressive and powerful. And like punk rock happened. And then that happened even in the 80s. And then the late 80s and 90s started this kind of alternative music, which makes me feel like the 60s. You know, it's mm-hmm. people like who don't bathe and like have real stringy hair and just play really weak guitar, you know, on a technical level. Not to say that there's not good songs in all forms of music, but technically the guitar level is not something that's going to make you want to get up and say, wow, let's start a band, you know, in my opinion. So hopefully this 90s cycle that we're in right now is kind of a repeat of the Woodstock age. Right. And hopefully that's going to like die out, and heavy metal is going to be like the battle of techno music to what disco was in the 70s. It was like all the heavy metal guys hated disco, and now this techno music is out now. It's really popular. So that's like a great target for all the would-be heavy metal dudes around the world. And that's mm-hmm. that's the way I feel about it. So I'm hoping that it's coming around, and I'm starting to see signs of it, you know, with this punk rock thing starting to happen again. I mean, of course, it's not the great Ramones or the Pistols or anything like that, but it's a step in the right direction, in my opinion.
Yeah, it seems like every generation is trying to outdo the previous.
Yeah, yeah. And then it goes backwards, you know, and then you got the hippies coming back. Yeah. And then, well, we'll see what happens in the next couple of years, you know. And a good thing about being in Megadeth is we're not following any trends, you know. We just do what we did from day one, and that's what one of the main things I really like about the band. Now Now I'm going to play a solo from a song called Dragon Mistress off my first solo album, Dragon's Kiss, and then Mitch and I are going to do a jam where I can ad-lib some soloing, a little bit different from the one that's on the record. But right now, let's try the one on the record and see if you can get the details of that. I think I'm going to use this guitar for most of my clean stuff, you think?
Yeah, I think it sounds great.
Best sounding one.
Somewhere between Hawaii and Japan, somewhere out in the middle there.
Nice talking to you.
Here we go again.
That was a song from Scenes. That was your second solo album.
Yes.
What took place in recording that album?
That was, it was recorded the same as any other record, except I had a lot more kind of atmospheric sounds, you know, a lot more kind of synthesizing pads under my guitar playing. And there was a lot less distorted guitar recording, which was the first time I recorded a lot of clean tone. Usually, you know, there might be a couple clean parts here and there, you know, doing hard rock music, but on my solo stuff, it required a very glassy, clean tone for my guitar, which was playing the majority of the melodies. So on Scenes, as in that clip there, I was playing a lot of kind of lead phrasing without lead tone, which kind of requires a different mindset about soloing. When you have distortion up and you're just cranking, you have like feedback to rely on and you have all kinds of power behind you. When you're playing with clean tone, you really have to feel the melody and not go on the charge of the power, you know what I mean? Right. You want to just play the melody that you hear and just try to get that onto tape, as opposed to playing with a heavy distortion where sometimes cool things happen by mistake, you know, and kind of feedbacks are in different keys than what you're playing in and it sounds really cool and things like that. When you're playing with clean tone, it's just what you're playing is what you get.
You did some acoustic stuff on that record too.
Sounds classical. Like it, but there wasn't any. It was all done on electric. It was actually, all the clean stuff was done on that guitar that's in the clip there. And like I said in the clip, that was the first take, which is very lucky because most of the takes were not first. That's why we're showing one of the quicker ones. Usually it took a lot longer than that.
Now, the album scenes, it seems like there's a theme you're following in that record, almost like there's a philosophy you're trying to reach. Was there something? Was there?
I think on Scenes is the first time that I could show the melodic side of my playing really, really clearly. Always in the past, I had that melodic side, but I had so much technique and guitar stuff that I really wanted to show as well, that sometimes in showing all that stuff at the same time, it got really crowded in there. And you could say, well, there's a melodic idea there, but there's just so much guitar going on, I can't really see what's happening. In Scenes, I pretty much abandoned all of the really manic guitar playing and only did what was really necessary and stripped off all of like the pyrotechnics, if you will. And on Scenes, it's pretty much the same melodic ideas I've always had, but since I'm in Megadeth and I'm playing heavy music every day, I really didn't need to do that again on a solo album. Mm-hmm. So I could really speak clearly musically with what I wanted to do. So that was the biggest gratification about Scenes, you know, because the melody is the melody, and there's not like a bunch of fretboard pyrotechnics covering everything up. Although the guitar was very cool, and I'm very happy with the guitar and proud of it, it was definitely not what I'd call a guitar album.
How much of a role did the producer play?
Being myself and Kitaro, Kitaro is one of my just idols. I mean, I think Kitaro is an amazing musician, and the fact that he even gives me the time of day, much less produce my album, it just blows my mind. It was really cool. I mean, he added a lot of things that he heard because he's got a lot more experience in playing kind of quiet soundtrack-like music. You know, I've been hearing that music for years, but that was the first time I ever recorded anything like that. So I did most of the tracks first, and then I sent the tapes to Kitaro, and he added some things. And I was going to have the final say what I was going to take off that he added and what I was going to leave, and I left every single thing that he put onto the tape. Just little embellishments, you know, like a tambourine part or little kind of foreign instruments in the background and kind of little... just embellishments, and he added a lot of little things that you can't really hear unless you listen for them, and really, really important to the vibe of the music. Mm-hmm. You know, he knows a lot about the subtle details of music, and that's what I really respect about him, that I learned a lot from him.
So what was that thing in the video you were, with the finger here while you were playing?
Oh, the other guy who had his...
He had his finger on...
Yeah, okay. What that is when I'm recording in the studio, I like to have my strings muted a little bit extra, because the way I play, if you noticed, my hand is like this and not like this. You know, if my hand was like this, I could be muting the strings as I play. But see, I don't really like that sound, that sound, you know. I like da 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 da, really clean and clear. And sometimes that runs the risk of open strings ringing by mistake, you know. And oftentimes when I'm in the studio, I'm trying to get a good take, you know, I'm trying to get really animated and involved, and sometimes I got the guitar going all over the place and I'm ringing the strings, you know, and sometimes I put a piece of tape on there and hold the strings from ringing that way, but the best way, if it's like a passage that's really got to be super clean, I'll have somebody put their hand there and kind of mute it, like just light enough to mute the strings without actually changing the pitch. I mean, if you had them all down like a capo or something, it'd be different, but just light enough to mute it. And actually, that's kind of a secret, you know. I don't like to talk about that so much, you know. That's kind of a little secret.
Okay, wipe that.
No. We'll forget about that. No, actually, we should keep that in there, you know, because it's really a good idea. Guys ask me, how do I mute? And sometimes That's how I'm you. Of course, I can't do it live, so I've just got to do the best I can. But in the studio, where everything is under the microscope and it's got to be really done clearly, sometimes I don't want to have an awesome, perfect take and have it ruined because there's an open string going sploing during the middle of the solo that you can't fix. So sometimes if I feel like I'm about to do something really cool, I'll have somebody put their finger there as opposed to putting a piece of tape there, which usually I have tape there the entire time. Of course, I have to take it off if I'm doing anything that has any open strings in it.
Right.
But kind of a secret. Don't like to tell anybody that, but
Too late now. What does the guys in Megadeth think about it, and your friends and your family, for that matter?
Everybody likes it, as far as I know. I mean, I don't know what they're saying behind my back. But the most important thing is it's exactly what I wanted to hear. And I think as I grow as a musician, I can play what I want to hear a lot clearer. You know, and I think people try to play music, and then when it comes out, they're not happy with it. Why is that? That's the great musical mystery of life. I mean, shouldn't it be every time you play, it's exactly what you intend to do? And as you grow up, you figure out that it takes years to be able to do that, to get back what you're hearing up here in your head. It takes a long time, you know, and I got lucky on that. Scenes is very close to what I'm hearing in my head.
Growing up, we've had similar influences. How have they affected you?
Good role models to start off with. Anybody who's successful playing music is a role model just by doing that. You know, it's so hard to make a living playing music, much less playing the music that you really like to play. So you have to look at people who are doing that and see what kind of similarities you have and what kind of chance you have to do that. And either way, you have to learn from those people. And when I started off, my influences were kind of a high level, you know, like Ulrich Roth and Frank Marino and those kind of guys. And I tried to play their stuff, and I'm like, wow, I'm never going to be able to play this. I got really discouraged. So I had to like look at guitarists and music that I was going to be able to play, or else I was going to wind up giving up because guitar seemed impossible, you know. And luckily, I heard the Ramones, which was my favorite group at the time, and still now I love this group. And it was so easy to figure out their music, and I got so much gratification from being able to play it. And then I moved into learning some Kiss stuff, you know, and the Ace Frehley's guitar stuff is very clear and classic melodies, you know. If a melody is like really clear and easy to understand, that's the easier it is to learn it at whatever level it is played at, now, however good you are, however well practiced you are. So his stuff was really classic and very memorable, so I learned a lot of Ace Frehley solos, and I was like an Ace Frehley clone when I first started off. I had to learn every single thing he did. So, and then after, you know, a couple of years, I started to piece together the better, more, not, I don't want to say better, but more technical guitarists, you know, like Ulrich Roth. And like I was saying before, I went back to his simplest stuff on the Flight of the Rainbow album and learned his little nuances. And then when I got a little bit better, I moved into his more difficult stuff as far as learning his solos. But I found that over the years, not too many guitarists have influenced me, but I find that I like the guys who do really clever stuff. Not the guys who are doing a lot of pyrotechnics and crazy guitar all over the place, but two guys who come to mind are Neil Giraldo from Pat Benatar's band and Elliot Easton from The Cars. I mean, you could never accuse those guys of overplaying, and every single thing they do is cool. Great melodies. Every little rhythm part, every little guitar embellishment, and especially the solos, are classic. And another guy like that is Brian May. Mm-hmm. I mean, you could never accuse this guy of like just overplaying. And every single thing he does just is clever. It sounds like him. It's got personality. It's beautiful. And I really like guys like that. And the guys that sometimes don't get the spotlight, like the Steve Vais and the Joe Satrianis. Of course, I can respect those guys as players and great musicians, but for me, I tend to go for the more clever, kind of unique sound of players like I just mentioned. And even guys who you can't really even hear their guitar playing very much, like the guitarist in Brian Adams' band. He plays what's right every time. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. He plays the right notes. Whatever they are, he's playing them. And the guitarist in Susie and the Banshees. You can barely hear his guitar, but when it comes out there, he's doing something cool and clever. And The Cure has amazing guitar lines, you know, and I tend to really enjoy listening to that more than, say, the guys who know every lick and every scale and every speed and all kinds of wildness.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of scales, do you have any scales that you like to do? Do you ever play around scales?
From this one song on my introduction album called Mama, the end of it has a scale type of thing. I usually don't play in scales, so to speak, modes and scales, because mm-hmm. then I'd be thinking way too much while I was playing, because I don't know the names of anything. You know, I know the names of the notes, and that's it. But scales and modes, it just confuse me, and I don't want to get confused. I want to try to play from my heart and just try to play... this is low notes and this is high notes. You know, I try to break it down to that, but of course you have to learn a lot of scales and a lot of patterns and stuff to learn to feel that way. But there's an example in that song which I'm going to play for you right now. I'm going to play along with the CD on that, and this is kind of a scale. I think it's a minor scale that lacks the fourth and the seventh. And it's a pattern that I do going descending. And the thing about it that's cool is it's a B minor scale played over an F sharp chord. So there's a tension of being a fourth above the chord you're playing over. And this is the end of the song, so it's kind of a finale. It's kind of dramatic. And I wanted it to be like a trumpet. I was thinking of kind of like a bullfighter almost in a ring, and a real kind of Herb Alpert dramatic trumpet vibe, just a lonely vibe. And I tried to do that with my note selection, and here's a good example of a scale descending that I would play.
You know, a lot of kids, I don't think they know how to get into a routine of practicing. Do you have any kind of routine for practicing that you follow?
When I was a lot younger, I definitely had a serious routine, and now, with my schedule the way it is, I look at playing live as being the practice, and that's the only kind of routine that's really routine in my life. I mean, you play a show, you do the next show, you do the next show, and that's mm-hmm. kind of routine. So I look at playing live as the best practice, and actually I always believe that, you know, even when you're just starting out and being in bands, I mean, one gig with your band is worth 20 days of practicing in your bedroom, you know, because you're like there, you're on the spot, and you have to do it, you know what I mean? So in the bedroom, nobody's going to hear if you make a mistake or anything like that, so I always believed that from the beginning, so I tried to just play out and in front of people as much as possible, and that was my practice, and I think that's a good habit, but of course behind closed doors you got to do a lot of actually boring, routine, kind of scale-like practicing. And I'll admit that I haven't done so much of that lately, you know. And if I practice now, there's usually something specific I'm working on, like maybe a piece for my solo album or something for Megadeth. Maybe a passage is a little bit difficult, or I want to come up with something that's a little bit more interesting, so I'll work specifically on a particular part. But I don't have what you'd say a routine of just general practice anymore. But when I did do quite a bit of that, I found that it's best to practice things that repeat, because you want to have a good sense of timing while you're soloing. You want to have a good sense of syncopation. So maybe I'll give a couple examples of really simple things that repeat and maybe are syncopated. Basically what I did was I took a C minor kind of position there, and I played things that were rhythmically repeating. That means I can take a metronome to it and get it completely tight at one speed and feel very comfortable about it, and then slowly, gradually bring it up to the next speed. And maybe there are three or four examples of patterns in there, but the most important thing is to never play at a speed that you're playing sloppy in. You know, you should always bring it down to something really slow and then build it up. But I would have hundreds of patterns like this, and I even kept them on a list. I wrote down, I don't know how I named these things, but somehow I gave them names, you know, C minor, whatever. And I made a list, and I had the date and what my metronome speed was where I could play it cleanly and precisely. And then I would just do it over and over and over again, you know. It really helped out, you know, because I feel that when I'm soloing along with music, I can break into this kind of thing at any time. But I haven't done that kind of practice in a long time.
Do you change the keys of the...
Yeah, do everything in every key. I mean, once you learn it in one key, you got to move it to another key, because then you don't want to be locked. A lot of times people learn stuff like exercises, and they learn it in one key, and they can use it in one key, but then they can't use it anywhere else, and it's completely wasted, because... Right. Most things are completely interchangeable without even changing your fingering. So it's really important to move everything around in the learning stages, too.
Be comfortable with it.
How about the picking and that type of thing? Are you conscious of, is it an up and down type picking? Or?
I was never one of those guys who was so completely conscious about picking. I was always more conscious with my left hand and the way it sounded. And that was enough for me to think about, you know.
The right hand just follows the left, pretty much whatever. Whatever the melody is you want to get out.
Whatever comes naturally for the right hand. I would try to, like, let the right hand just happen, you know, because, like, someone would show me something and say, okay, you have to pick it right hand, up, up, down, down, up, alternate picking, and that would just totally confuse me and discourage me. So I concentrated on trying to get the sound out that I wanted to hear and let my finger, let my right hand just kind of do it. And usually I got pretty lucky with that way, you know, because it's just way confusing if you are conscious of that. Now, they're probably most better guitar players than I am are very conscious of that, and I'm just not.
What's evolved in the composition?
One of the things that has always been important to me in arranging and composition is adding of supporting parts and building, like a house gets built. You got your foundation, and then you got a little part above that, and you can still hear that part while you're adding another part on top of that, and then possibly you solo over that. That sounds confusing now, but I think I'm going to give you an example. I'm going to play along with the main theme and first solo from a song called Forbidden City from my Dragon's Kiss album, and you should be able to understand what I mean about building the house.
Great.
So like in that example, the chord progression was established. It was like B minor, E minor, G, A, B minor. Chord progression was established. Then I did that open string thing, which is kind of a constant arpeggiation of the chords. That's building up that foundation, right? So you know what the progression is. You anticipate the chords. And then I did that little melody, you know, da, 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 type of thing in B minor. And then now we got the rhythm in the back with the bar chords, and we got this arpeggiation here going on, and then we got this melody that's very slow with a lot of space in it, and then I went to this singing, crying melody type of thing up at top.
Right.
So at this point, all these things are going on together, and nothing is stepping on each other, and we're just kind of building it this way. And then when the solo started to get more intense, I just lost the arpeggiation in this melody here and just started concentrating on just really singing up here, way in this register. But it's a very good example of how I like to build a house, basically, with soloing and with melodies that kind of intertwine with each other.
When you did that first melody, it goes back to what you were saying about the rhythm picking up some of the slack. You were doing the staccato rhythm in the background, like broken chord kind of progression.
Yeah, if I keep the melody really simple, then the chords in the back can do the work. And I was repeating the same melody over and over again. Da 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 da, like that. Chords are changing behind it, everything's going on, drums are bashing, but the melody is just doing a constant. And this arpeggiation is also a constant, so it's like a machine kind of just churning, like inside of a clock or a watch. Everything's got its own space and it's moving. And then, after you've built up this whole thing with all the tension and everything, on top is just singing this melody and just crying over it. And that, to me, is what I look for and something I try to do. So that time I accomplished what I was trying to do. Of course, it takes a lot of space to build up such a thing, and you can't always do that in the context of a rock song. You know, you don't have like 90 bars to create this thing, you know, but that in a nutshell is what I try to do, regardless of how much space I have.
Can you explain your vibrato?
My vibrato. I'll try to explain it. Before I do that, you know, an important thing about learning the way someone else plays is that when you can learn exactly the same notes that the guy's playing and every phrase exactly the same, but it doesn't sound the same, usually it's the vibrato that's different. And that's a nuance of someone's playing. It's a very small but very, very important part. And it has to do with which finger on which string gets used, because each finger has a different vibrato sound. And so I would say if there's one thing to learn from this video or any video is you should learn the fingering exactly the same as what's on the video, because that's going to show you kind of between the lines of what's going on. I mean, part of it is learning my exact fingering, because that's going to tell you a lot about the vibrato. It's going to tell you a lot about the way it sounds the way it sounds. And you shouldn't necessarily do the left-hand fingering the way it feels good for you. Do your right hand the way, any way you want. But with the left hand, if you're going to learn anything from this video or any video, you want to really copy it exact. So aside from that, I'll give you some examples of different kinds of vibrato. This vibrato, to me, is just your basic rock vibrato. Kind of a wavering sound, and it kind of rumbles your heart a little bit. You know, you want to just keep playing it, you know, but it's important to keep it in tune as you're doing. And I do another kind of thing where I don't vibrate it as much, but I might bend from a half step as opposed to a whole step. It's a lot faster vibrato if you use your second finger and go down like this without bending. And then there's something that I do quite often that sounds kind of weird. It's bending up to a half step bend and bending back down and back up really quickly, like this. Slowly it sounds like, but you exaggerate the first part of it and it gives you kind of a bend sound. But the vibrato is a really touchy thing. You can't really copy another guy's thing. You just gotta like try to feel it and stay in tune is the best advice I can give to you.
I heard that you like a form of music called Enka music from Japan.
Mm-hmm.
What, can you explain what Enka music is?
What it is?
Yeah, I'm totally, I've never even heard of it.
Never heard of it, yeah. I figure that if you learn from music from other cultures, you're gonna pick something different that most people don't know, and you're gonna have a little bit warped guitar style because of that. So, I studied music from foreign cultures, and I really came to like this music called Enka music, which is, I would say, the Japanese equivalent to country music, but it's a little bit more sad, in my opinion. You know, it's usually really sad, but the singers, the famous singers, have a really strong voice and a strong vibrato and a really crying sound, and I'm like, God, I want to have that sound in my guitar, you know, and they call it kobushi. It's kind of the vibrations of the voice, and it's very sad, and it's very powerful at the same time. So I said, that's perfect for guitar. How can I learn that from vocals? So I would try to find the best singers, the most popular singers, and learn some of their vocal techniques. Mm-hmm. So what I did was just listen to it and copy the melody and try to copy every nuance of their vibrato. And maybe I'll play a little example of something like that that would possibly be a vocal line in a Japanese Enka song.
Great.
Okay, the thing about that is you really have to look at the nuances of what I just played. And what I play is, as opposed to, those are the small details that you really want to know. And the vibrato, like a voice shaking. And when you do those pull-offs, I'm copying the vocals. The vocals sometimes do kind of like those dips in and out like that. Instead of going, I might go.
Is there a solo that you do on one of your records that could demonstrate?
Oh, that's a good question. I'm sure there is. And you're probably asking, how did I use that Enka influence in that solo? I definitely didn't use it at the end where I'm burning up really fast. Most guys would probably play the melody something like this. That's how most guys would phrase the melody, because that's what the melody is. But I would probably phrase it something like this. The way it was had a lot of the Enka feeling to it, the vocalist feeling. So the half step bending, instead of a typical rock phrase like that, I went, or even without picking the last note. So it's important for you to catch this whole thing, because it's so easy to get trapped into phrasing melodies like every other guitar player, and all it takes is just a little conscious effort to bend from different frets and to vibrate with the intent of singing. Because when you're playing a slow melody on guitar, you're just singing. You just happen to be playing guitar. So again, I would play it like this.
What kind of gear are you using?
Gear? I use something I don't really know much about. But I use VHT power amps, I use a custom audio electronics preamp, I use a Bradshaw switching system, a couple Yamaha SPX 900s. Don't use effects very much. You know, I always believe that the tone comes from the fingers. Mm-hmm. And I use crate cabinets and sound great everywhere I go.
It's an intricate rig. For someone young starting out, what would you recommend?
Marshall amp. crate amps, I should say that. I mean, I'll be honest, I use crates because they're great and they work great for me. And I think the original idea for heavy metal is a Marshall. We all know that. There's no denying that. And so my crate sounds just as good, if not better, than a Marshall. But, you know, we all go for that sound. You can get it from many different amps. So, you know, there's a lot of amps out there that sound good. Just get a simple amp. You don't need a lot of effects. Get a distortion, maybe a chorus, and then go to town.
And what kind of picks, strings are you using?
I use my own picks, which are
Marty Friedman picks,
similar to Fender heavies, and they feel like Fender heavies. And strings, I use Dean Markley's Magnums 10-52. We'll be right back.
Megadeth. You were in a group called Cacophony with Jason Becker, another great guitar player. What was he all about?
Great guitar player is an understatement. He's a genius, really. There's no other way to put it. I mean, he was the guy in Cacophony. If there was something that was too hard for me to play, he would play it. He was that guy, and beyond that, I mean, he grew up a lot during those Cacophony years. We were, he was like 16 or 17 when I first met him and we first started jamming, and he had an enormous amount of talent, like dexterity, fingering, and he could play like anything. But his improvising skills were the only thing where he kind of lacked. And he just learned so quickly. I was working on my material over at his house. He had a home studio, and I'd say, yeah, why don't you learn some of this? Maybe we can jam it together someday. I'd come back the next day, he'd have it all down, all my phrases just nailed, and here, you should play it like this, you know? And he just blew me away. I'm like, dude, we got to start a band. And it really became ridiculous how good he got in such a short period of time. I mean, he improved at a rate like no one I've ever seen. I mean, he was already amazing. And then over the 2-3 years that we jammed together, he just did things on guitar that I couldn't comprehend. He's just like a true, true composer, like of a Beethoven or Bach status. Mm-hmm. You know, and I think when his new album comes out, people are going to see that.
Right. How about Dave Mustaine? How's working with him?
That's a completely different situation. Completely different situation. We are very good friends, and we work together, but we almost never sit down and play guitar together, mm-hmm. You know, and just for the sake of playing guitar. When we play guitar, you know, we have a distinct goal in mind. You know, we're either rehearsing for a tour, or working on material for an album, or we're in the studio, working out solos or working out rhythms or something. There's a very distinct goal, you know, and Jason and I, we just jam all the time and see what happens, you know. Right. And I think the main difference is we don't really have that kind of time now, you know. In Megadeth, our schedules are just out of control, so we're on tour practically all year long, you know, and we need to have a little time off and spend with our families at home. So that kind of jamming, you know, happened in the old days a lot more, and we pretty much just jam when the red light's on in Megadeth. But Dave is an amazing visionary of rock music. He's got his own voice. By voice, again, I mean sound that he hears in his head and that he can get the sound from his head to the tape, you know? And I think that's what the musicians that people recognize have. You know, it's not a matter of being lost and searching for your sound. Is this my sound, or what is my sound like? Trying a different sound each year. You know, he knows very much what his sound is, and I respect that about him. And that's what I try to have for my own thing as well. So, and plus the guy knows how to work. I mean, he gets a lot of stuff done and motivates us all in the band.
That's great. Shows. What have you been listening to lately? What kind of music?
You know, I think that lately there hasn't really been anything that attracts me to some new music, but I have a theory about that. And I think that when you're like 14 and 15, early teen years, that's when your influences get decided and that's when your favorite music gets chosen. And then, especially in the music business where you're working with music all the time and music is your life, the new things that are happening and the trends kind of bounce off, you know, and it's not like you're going to get influenced again like you did when you were a teenager, you know. When you're growing up, you're really excited about this great new band, and you kind of get immune to that as you grow up. So I think the bands that I really liked growing up are still my favorite bands now as far as rock goes. I mean, the Ramones are my favorite band, although it sounds nothing like my music. I mean, if I were to listen to something, I think I'd listen to them, you know. Ramones, Sex Pistols, early Kiss, early Scorpions, and I don't listen to too much hard rock, you know, on my free time listening to music. I listen to a lot of music from other countries, you know. Pop music from Japan I like because I'm studying Japanese, and sometimes the lyrics are easy to understand and it makes it easy to study. I like traditional Japanese music, and I really like Chinese music. The instrument that the Chinese use that's similar to a violin called an erhu, has a sound that I want to imitate on guitar so much. It's just a beautiful sound. It's very sad and weeping and crying and singing instrument. I think it has like two or three strings on it. And I listen to a lot of that just to hope that some of that sound seeps into my mind so I can play that way. And I enjoy that music as well. But I started off listening to 50s music exclusively. I only liked stuff from the 50s, you know, the real rocking stuff, you know,
Chuck
the Elvis,
Berry kind of
Chuck
stuff.
Berry, you know,
Bill
Haley and the Comets, all that stuff. Not for the guitar, but just because I liked the attitude of that kind of stuff. And I still like 50s music because the songs are songs and they're easy to understand. And it's just fun stuff. So that's what I'd listen to in my own spare time.
What took place at the rehearsals? Other than rehearsal, would you guys,
well, you
guys
know how
drugs or anything?
You know how that a lot of rock bands, especially young rock bands, when you're like 15 and stuff like that, young rock bands like to experiment in getting high and stuff like that because they think it's part of the rock star culture.
Where do you stand now on it, on drugs?
I like really have a serious idea about that. I quit doing drugs when I was 17, and when I first started playing guitar, I was getting high quite regularly, and I thought, you see, I can still play very well, you know, and I'm getting high all the time. It's no problem. It doesn't keep me from playing well at all. No problem. And that was kind of like my big point. I can get as high as I want and still play great. Watch. And then I thought to myself, you know what? If I can play like this while I'm high, you know, what would happen if I stopped taking drugs, you know, and would I improve or would I get worse? And it's funny, as soon as I stopped getting high, I just like improved tenfold. I could play so much better. I could hear clearly, and if I wanted to learn something, I learned it like much quicker than I did before. And that revelation made me quit getting high, you know, and it really, really helped. And I'm glad it happened at an early age because I wasn't so attached to getting high that it was an addiction or anything like that. But I'll tell you, stopping drugs definitely was the best thing I ever did for my guitar playing. I suddenly got better than everybody in my neighborhood.
With the touring that you do, constant touring, I mean, it would be almost impossible. I don't see how these guys stay on drugs.
Yeah, I think I couldn't do what I'm doing now if I was high. It'd be totally impossible. And of course, it was kind of the macho challenge thing to do, you know, back in the early days, and especially since that was my first band in Deuce, and it was so much fun, you know. Don't get me wrong. I mean, we had a blast getting high, partying, doing gigs, and it was just the most fun I could possibly ever have. But when I wanted to get serious about doing anything with my life, I really had to like get rid of drugs, and that was a lot of fun. And now I'm in this band, Megadeth, and we're also having a lot of fun, but we're really, really working our asses off, and our schedule is just out of control. You know, we're touring, you know, 11, 12 months a year, and then we go right into the studio, and we write, and we record, and then we do press all the time, and we can't look hungover, and we're jet lagged all the time because we're flying around the world all the time, and I couldn't see where drugs would fit in. Mm-hmm. And I'm really glad I stopped.
Thank you.
have a message for our viewers?
Our viewers, first of all, thank you very much for getting this video, and I think you're going to learn something, and I think you're going to have a good time watching it, and hopefully, especially seeing the old demo stuff, you know, hope you guys are still my fans. Hope I didn't lose any fans, and keep playing, and do great. Enjoy this video. Watch it again. See ya.